Hello all. My next 15 minutes are going to be a bit disturbing, because as I always say that these are realities and realities are there to disturb. We work on a very basic issue, which has never been considered an issue, which has never been considered a subject. There's something to do with clothing, which means clothes to people. A very mundane thing, a very taken for granted. We had certain questions in our mind. When we said that when you talk about three basic need of humankind, you say roti, kapda aur makan, food, cloth and shelter. When you talk about issues to work on, you have 100-150 issues, from domestic violence to global warming. How come clothing never finds a place in the list of issues? How come it has so happened that cloth has actually become a disaster relief material? So the moment an earthquake or flood happens, you think of people who need clothes. Although the fact remains that disaster hit people do not need clothes, because clothing is something which you store. First thing which a disaster hit person loses is the storage capacity. So even the second pair of cloth is a burden. But if earthquake is a disaster, if flood is a disaster, how come winters are not a disaster? Why don't we have figures of people who die or suffer in winters? And mind you, in earthquake the shake kills people, in flood the water kills people, in the accident the impact kills people, but in winters the cold does not kill people. Because in the same temperature, if I survive and someone else dies, it's not the cold but the lack of clothing. Just to give you some stories to tell you that how grave is the subject and how ignored is the subject. One goes back to 91-92. I had done my mass communication. Like a new journalist, you try to look for a story. And I was roaming around on the roads of Old Delhi, which is the hub of a story, about 1.5 lakh homeless people in the city of Delhi itself. Lot of people migrate in search of job. Suddenly I see this rickshaw, on which in Hindi it was written, Police Seva Lavaris Lasht Hone Wala, Delhi Police Ka Lasht Hone Wala, which means a person who picks up unclaimed, abandoned dead bodies for Delhi Police. A very strange profession. I follow him, spend about a week with him to understand that how does it operate, what does he do. Basically, a whole lot of people die on the roads due to hunger, due to accident, due to drugs, lack of food, lack of cloth, various reasons. The entire system does not want to get into the cycle of missing people report, finding out the relatives of that person. All these people will come to Habib Bhai and his wife, blind wife Amna Begum, will inform them that there is a dead body lying somewhere. Habib Bhai with his blind wife would go, pick up the dead body, bring it to the crematorium, dump it. Between two paid cremation, people will cremate that person whose relatives are still waiting somewhere. Two statements came up. One, when Habib Bhai said, ki saab, जाड़ों में मेरा धंधा बढ़ जाता है, कभी कभी इतना काम होता है कि मुझसे संभलता नहीं. इन विंटर्स माई वर्क गोज अप, मेनी टाइम्स आई हैव सो मच ऑफ वर्क दैट आई कांट हैंडल इट. टू माई एट अ सरप्राइज, इन 91-92 हबीब भाई यूज टू पिक अप 10 टू 12 डेड बॉडीज इन अ साइकिल ऑफ 24 आवर्स जस्ट फ्रॉम एन एरिया ऑफ 4 to 5 किलोमीटर इन ओल्ड दिल्ली. इन द समर द एवरेज यूज टू बी 4 to 5, 7-8 एडिशनल डेथ due to lack of clothing. He had a small daughter who is a grown-up girl now, is married, who gave a very shocking statement. When she said, जब मुझे ठंड लगती है तो मैं लाश के साथ चिपक कर सो जाती हूं. She further said, लाश तंग नहीं करती, लाश करवट नहीं बदलती. When I feel cold, I hug the dead body and sleep. It does not trouble me. It does not turn around. In the capital of the country, outside a big hospital where you have a footfall of 5,000, 6,000 people on a daily basis, a few kilometers away from people like us whose wardrobes are always full of material waiting for a disaster to empty out, there is a child who is forced to sleep with a dead body to keep herself warm. What about the remote parts of the country, remote parts of the world? One dimension. The second most important dimension. We said that every single woman across the world needs a piece of cloth for a very taboo subject called menses, called period. We don't want to talk about it. Although the fact remains that half the world belongs to these people, half the world need this piece of cloth. But in a scenario where you do not have enough to cover yourself, from where and how you bring that piece of cloth? In 2004, we Googled to find out what is this, what is happening in this entire area, and suddenly found that there is actually nothing happening in the area. It's absolutely grossly ignored subject. We started traveling in the villages of India. Some of the findings. They use the dirtiest piece of cloth, if at all it is available, because for them it's the synonym of dirt. They wash it, they cannot dry it in sunlight because of obvious reasons. With moisture they wear it. In the slums, they dry it behind the door. Before the manfolk comes at about 6:37, they pick up the cloth, dump it in a corner. Next day, with moisture and dust, they wear it. Then we found that you have 2 to 3 women in the family. The cycles are different. They're sharing the same piece of cloth. We also found that it is not only shared in the family, but even the neighbors share this piece of cloth. If you go to beautiful island of Sundarbans in West Bengal, you will find women who are using the same piece of cloth for over a year. It has become a stole, but it is still used as a sanitary pad. Millions of women across the globe, not only in India, are using sand, ash, jute gunny bag, dari ka tukla, sacks of gunny bag, newspaper, husk, sand. Anything and everything which they think can absorb is used as a sanitary pad because they do not have the simple piece of cloth. We have cases where a lady used a piece of blouse which had a hook. Died of tetanus. We found a case where a centipede entered through the body and the lady died. We went to a village where in the age group of 18 to 40, a large number of women lost their uterus because the moment an infection happened, they were told that now there are chances of cervical cancer, you better remove the uterus. My question, what do these women need? Do they really need anything fancy or just a simple piece of cloth? These two aspects, just to give you a larger perspective of something which is the first visible sign of poverty, where you decide on the status of people, on what they wear, whether they wear or not. 12 years back, we started working on this basic ignored issue with a clear-cut motto that we have to grow as an idea. We didn't want to grow as an organization. We wanted it to bring in the list of subjects. We wanted people to understand that it is an important thing. Just because none of us has ever felt the nakedness in the market, just because all of us have felt hunger sometime, just because all of us have felt homelessness, we talk about it, but none of us has actually gone out without a single piece of cloth, we don't know what and how big is the problem. Started with 67 clothes in 1998. We deal with about 70-80 tons of material today. The only difference, we say that when you say that I want to donate cloth, that is actually a wrong statement, that's an overstatement, because the fact remains you never donate, you actually discard cloth. So the most appropriate word for a second-hand used cloth is that you want to discard because it is a liability on you. because it is a burden on you and you want to get rid of it. So the fact remains that the person who is wearing your second-hand used cloth is actually doing a service to you. That's the repositioning, a statement of something which is important. The second most important aspect, in a very typical manner, we collect it from the cities, it is processed in a very rigorous manner, and then it goes to the villages. We argued that the biggest asset of village people across the globe is something called self-respect, is something called dignity. You don't find beggars in the villages. Begging is a typical city phenomena. Beggars are found in the cities. So by donating something, why do we challenge the dignity of the people who never come to you to ask for it, but you want to give it to them? So the initiative which is evolved is something called cloth for work, where now this old material, tons of old material, is being used as a resource. People have started calling it a parallel economy now, where people work on various issues, right from cleaning up a village to repairing of road, to developing drainage system, to make these kind of well at absolutely no cost, where the entire community work to do something good for the village, and instead of money, they receive material, they receive cloth, utensil, footwear, all kind of material. Or like a bridge like this, a 240 feet by 6 feet bridge, where a bike can go on this, and it's there for the last 3 years at a cost of less than $50, less than 2,250 rupees, just by the contribution of people in terms of the free shramdan, as we call it, or under the program cloth for work. Lot of examples like that, where we are just trying to say is it does not only take care of the very basic need of clothing, but also it is a dignified act of giving. Old toys to be converted into Anganwadis, and the most appropriate reaction from a worker who said, "Pehle bachcha aata nahi tha, ab bachcha jata nahi." Earlier the child never used to come, now the child does not want to go. The impact is just your old toys. This is what you have just seen. We certainly want to make it a dining table subject, because this is something which is related to half the world. I remember in 2007, when we won this Development Marketplace Award from the World Bank, we were there at DC. Whole lot of people were grilling us on sustainability and miserability. Last question was asked. When we asked that you are the biggest funders on this earth in terms of health projects, how many health projects have you ever funded which have a separate budget for sanitary napkins? And the answer was hardly any. The argument is that do you really need a qualitative or quantitative analysis? Or it is just a bit of common sense that if you solve the basic issue of clothing, basic issue of sanitary napkin, half the women health related issues will not even come up. Before I leave, just these two photographs. You see this kid, you react. In Hindi you say bechara. This child belongs to a poor family, this child is hungry, this child is naked. Tell me if you can really use even a single word for this kid, which you use for this kid. The only difference is a pair of cloth. You go to a village, you see this person, you don't even go near to him. Suddenly, the person becomes Kaka. Suddenly, you are actually worried, you are actually thinking again, is he a landlord? The same person, the only difference is a pair of cloth. Thank you very much.